Agnis Stibe works in a group called Changing Places Research Group at MIT Media Laboratory. And he will take us to mega cities of tomorrow. Human race will be residing in those mega cities. And he will tell us today, how can you imagine cities that feel, understand, and take care of your well-being? So that's an ultimate goal after having interactive makeup that helps you with communications, then maybe some other objects in the city can do the same. And we won't have to ask consumers if they want to be using digital health. It will be out there for them.
Well, that's exactly correct. So many effort has been put into engineering different kind of devices and different kind of tools to help individuals maintain more healthier lifestyles. At the same time, there's a huge environmental impact from the environments that we spend time. And beyond that, beyond engineering and beyond the environment is actually the social psychology. Social psychology that underpins what we think and what we do. And this talk is gonna be about the vision of the future cities that's gonna be complemented with technology that will be designed specifically to influence what people think and do. So, and here's gonna be an example of it. So how many of you have seen this before? All right. What was that? What was the construction over there? Eiffel Tower, right. Paris, real thing. A construction that has been built more than 100 years ago for a certain purpose now has completely different way of using it. So it can be used as a very visible communication channel to the citizens and to the tourists of the Paris. And it can be used beyond just like spreading the lights and communicating different kinds of messages. As you saw, there was a numbers like counting upwards, which means it can be used as instant feedback of the crowd dynamics in a city. And also the lights can change the color depending on what the purpose is, or what districts are performing better than the others if they are color-coded, and so forth. That's an example how for the future cities will use the built infrastructure, will overlay that with the feedback channels, technology-driven, with the screens, with the lights, with the sounds, and so forth, to communicate what's happening, and especially exemplifying crowds of people that have healthy and sustainable routines. And this is another example. So where persuasive messaging has been used, where this one at the bottom says that this one runs on money and makes you fat, and the other one on the top, this runs on fat and saves you money. And although we know, or at least most of us know, that this is how it is, we still have a behaviors that are not contributing to our well-being. And the theories that I use for the work and looking at the future cities, as I call them, persuasive cities. I look at the work of psychologists from Stanford, especially this gentleman, Albert Bandura, and social cognitive theory, which says that our environment around us and what we think and what we do within this environment as are interconnected three elements. And they are reshaping each other as we behave or think, or we change the environment. So whenever we do a change in one of these, it instantly affects the two others. And one of the areas that I work on is mobility, and mobility in the cities. And if you look at the streets right now on the left, this is how the streets or the mobility is organized in the cities. What we actually would like to have in the future is on the right-hand side. And as you can see, that picture on the right-hand side would be much more beneficial for our health and well-being. And now I'm going to show you another example, which is on the borderline between persuasion and deception. But I really like it. So, choice of stairs and elevator. So, this way, people can be decepted or coerced into the stairs and elevator. And by the way, we here at the MIT Media Lab are going to run studies specifically towards how to persuade people to use stairs more often. And if you look at the future cities, and ideally, and remembering back the triangle of the three elements, certainly the winning strategy is the environment. The environment, so pretty much rebuild the city, re-engineer it, enable new modes of transportation that are more healthier, enable different kind of ways and behaviors and the environments for living, more eco-friendlier, whatever. More energy-saving tools and mechanisms. That's the ideal way to go. What's the limitation here? So what's the difficulty here? Because rebuilding and redesigning the city will take years and millions and billions. So the question is, if you look back to the triangle, what we can do right now, there is this other element on the top, which is we can do something about what people think about their behaviors. Because ultimately, their behaviors are determined either by the environment or by the attitude or by the both. So while we are, in the long run, redesigning the cities, what we can do today, we can work with the strategies towards shaping the attitudes towards better, healthier lives. If you look at the motivators that has been used for decades. So those are carrots and sticks. So either you incentivize people to do something or you punish them if they don't do the right thing. Again, very well known, very well studied, very well being proved to be successful, but still very limited. What the limitation with these two guys? First of all, somebody needs to maintain them. Somebody needs to go give out the incentives. Somebody needs to stand with the stick. So that requires an extra effort. But secondly, and most importantly, what happens if they are taken away? So imagine you are motivated by a discount to a gym for 2 months. And then after 2 months, this discount disappears. So, and these kind of similar situations, when you take the incentive away, most likely the behavior converts back to original. So these are the huge limitations. But again, it's not the end of the world. There are other sources of motivation or other sources of how attitudes can be influenced. And this is the power of others, or scientifically social influence. So if you walk on the street and you see this happening, what do? You just look up. You don't reason. You just reactively do what the majority does. And by the theory, it says, so we are constantly influenced by the behaviors of other people around us, whether they are actual, imagined, or implied. And now if we use this powerful source of influence that is from the others and use technology to exemplify that through different kinds of systems, this is where the socially influencing systems originate. So we have typical technology on the right-hand side. It can be any kind of information system you use. Accounting, document management system, Facebook, you name it. On the right-hand side, these are the 7 social influence principles from the theories of social psychology. They are 7. I will walk a little bit through each of them, but very quickly. And the most important here is, if the social influence is powerful in the physical world, now just for the technology specialists is the question how we together can design the features that would have the same effect through the technology. And if you go down into each of these 7 principles, they have very many dimensions. And for the designers, it's very important. But for you today, it will be just a brief introduction of 7 of these. Social learning, so people learn by others, like by observing others. So if others are chopping wood, you can watch it for 10 minutes and you learn how to do it. Comparison, we typically compare ourselves with others. We look at those who are better than us to get an inspiration. We look at those who are not that well performing as us to boost our self-esteem. We look for social norms. They typically are written as a statements. Don't smoke here. Or if the statement is not written anywhere, we look at what the majority does. Social facilitation, we are more inclined, more motivated to do something if we are doing that behavior together with others at the same time in the same place. For example, running a marathon. Well, most likely you're gonna do it waking up one morning. But if you know that there is a Boston Marathon one day, you are getting prepared and you're more motivated to do that. And the last 3 are quite self-evident. So people tend to cooperate if the setting is cooperative. People tend to compete if the setting is competitive. And people enjoy receiving a public recognition for their good behavior or achievements. So you're the best in swimming or you're the best in class. You would try to motivate, or you will be more motivated to keep this title for the next term. On top of that, these 7 principles, they are interlinked and interconnected. This is more sophisticated view on this, but the most important takeaway from here is color-coded. So if you design something, it can be more targeted to tackle attitude first. So what you think, whether you think the water is tasty or not tasty, that's an attitude. So normative influence social comparison is more effective to start there, to tackle the attitude first. If you want to get people to do something and you are not that much concerned about their attitudes, so you can start with social facilitation and cooperation, you just bring them into cooperating on something. And then while they're doing, they can shape their attitudes. And if you want people to be very actively engaged, very quickly to do a certain thing, competition and recognition are the ways to get people engaged. And social learning has a white collar because that's like a fundament for all the human evolution. So we always look around, we see what others are doing, we're learning from that. Now let's look at one of the examples for a person who would like to start running in the morning. And this is a typical way how we look at the weather forecast. We see a temperature, we see weather conditions, and there are 3 different cities around the globe, Stanford, Eindhoven, and Chicago, different temperatures, different weather conditions. And there's a small feature in the top right corner, which says how many people are jogging at that moment in a neighborhood. And we can see in Stanford, there are 374, in Eindhoven is 12, and in Chicago is 0. So this is a feature which represents social facilitation. So how many others at this point in the morning are out there in your neighborhood running. And as you can see, depending on how many are there, it can either motivate you more, or it can decrease your motivation, or it can revert the effect of the feature. That's why designers of the features that are based on social influence have to be very mindful. Because in the case of Chicago, most likely that feature has to be switched to some other one. For example, not today this morning, but across the last 2 months, at the same time, in a similar weather condition, there were some number of people. Because there are always somebody. Because there are always somebody riding the bike in Boston in January and February, like I did. So there are always people that are highly motivated. Using that crowd as a source for motivation is the way to go. Another thing, there are so many things have been designed for apps. Apps that help you to reduce weight, apps to help you to quit smoking, and so forth. Again, there is a small trouble with this. Apps. So imagine you are a user, you are helping yourself with achieving a goal that's related with your well-being, and it's this app-based solution. It's who is in control? And I go for smoke. Whereas if we design something for the environment like this, this is an implementation of instant feedback of how quickly you can move around either with a car or with a bike. You can see that you cannot switch it off. It's there. It's based on the real traffic. So no one has any agenda behind it. So it's just a reflection of what's happening. And by this instant feedback through the environment, you can receive extra motivation of what actually you want to do. And this is partially informative, but it's very highly motivational at the same time. What we did recently in Cambridge and Boston, we engaged 14 companies and asked their employees commuting to their work to report what kind of transportation modes they have chosen. And I specifically looked at the bicycling. And beyond engaging them to report their bicycling and enabling the participants to see that, we asked companies to display on the screens in their premises the rankings. So everyone else who is not riding the bike, everyone else in a company is exposed to where the company stands in the ranking. And the only way how a single employee could influence the ranking is take a ride with the bike. So these are the another example how we scale it up beyond these devices, more of a awareness to the larger crowd of what's actually happening. And before going and trying to design something for the behavior change, there is a very simple formula. And this is important. Whenever you think about yourself or your friends and colleagues and relatives, any group that you think have to change the behavior, including yourself, you need to be very specific. Who is the target audience? Who is the target group? In case of yourself, that's simple. But in another case, if you are employer or you are a business person and you look at your customers, you have to be very specific, or you are health-related professional. You need to clearly know. This is the target audience, and what makes the target audience specific or distinguishable is their behavior, a certain behavior that time? All right. So just to finish this up, define your target behavior, and their present behavior makes them distinguish. You are not satisfied with that, and define the future behavior. That's a formula to start with if you want to design something for the behavior change. So is this it? Time is up. Perfect.